Bloomberg News on demand. Bloomberg on the Economy with Tom Keene. Thursday, September 10th, 2009.
I'm Pim Fox, in for Tom Keene. Joining us for this hour is Mark Faber, investor and publisher of the Gloom, Boom, and Doom Report. He joins us from Thailand. Mark Faber, begin by talking about the world of a depressive optimist. The title of the most recent Gloom, Boom, and Doom Report says you're a depressive optimist, but to link that with what is going on with the leadership in the United States, particularly the economic leadership. Let's start there. Why are you depressed?
Well, basically, I think that the global economy is kind of recovering or has stabilized, and obviously asset markets have performed fantastically well since March. As you know, stock markets are up 50% to 100% from their lows, depending on markets. But what worries me and what depresses me is that the same policy makers are still there who brought about the crisis. In other words, Mr. Bernanke and Mr. Tim Geithner and so forth, that were largely responsible through their monetary policies for bringing on the crisis. They are now in charge of getting us out of it, and they apply essentially the same measures they applied after 2001, which then created a huge credit bubble and the housing boom, the refinancing boom, the excessive consumption, and eventually the collapse. So that depresses me to a large extent. And I think that, as David Rosenberg recently said, this rally is built on quicksand. But obviously it's a rally, and when I look at the performance of individual stocks, I see a lot of breakout moves with big volume on the upside from bases that they formed over the last 6 to 9 months. So that I have to respect. So we have a rally, we have rising asset markets, but it's not the type of bull market I like that is based on sound fundamentals. That depresses me.
Part of what you've written indicates that whoever can engineer a rally in equities through monetary measures is a hero. So in that case, do we have a lot of heroes out there?
Well, I mean, I don't think that someone who engineers a rally in equity markets through monetary policies is a hero. You can boost any kind of asset by printing money. What then happens? You can print money, whether that is physically with a printing press or electronically. What you don't really control are the long-term consequences of the money printing. In other words, the money then flows into the system, and it can go into commodities, or it can go into equities, or it can go into art prices, it can go into wages, and it can go into consumption. And when you have large excess capacities and when you have very high unemployment, it doesn't go into capital spending, into the construction of new factories, into the acquisition of equipment and machinery and R&D, but it goes mostly into speculation.
Turn your attention now to Federal Reserve Chairman Ben Bernanke. We know he has been reappointed by President Barack Obama to a second term as the head of the Fed. Do you think that there's been enough scrutiny of his performance? A lot of people blame Alan Greenspan for the asset price bubble. Does some of that responsibility fall on the shoulders of Ben Bernanke?
Well, I think you can put the two of them in the same boat. And whereas the bubble after 2001, and by the way, also the bailout of LTCM and the bailout of Mexico in 94 and the money printing throughout the period, especially preceding the Nasdaq peak in 2000, was Mr. Greenspan. The architect behind the intellectual architect was largely Mr. Bernanke, who argued we can prevent recessions and we can prevent the depression by essentially flooding the system with liquidity, by taking extraordinary measures, which would include, in his words, dropping dollar bills from helicopters onto the United States. So we had first essentially a Greenspan put, and then we had the Bernanke put with a higher striking price. And that led to essentially an increase in leverage because interest rates were artificially low. It's like today. We have zero interest rate. So you have, say, $1 million on deposit, you don't get any interest. So the system, the central bank, essentially forces you to do something to achieve some kind of return. So you take the $1 million and either you buy equities or you buy commodities or you buy some bonds or you buy foreign currencies, but you do something, and that then leads to a lot of volatility in financial markets.
Talk a little bit more about the thinking of Ben Bernanke in the most recent issue of the Gloom, Boom, and Doom report. There's a lot of attention devoted to the way in which he approaches the world economy. Indeed, the concept being that he writes a lot about money, for example, but not much about banking. His essays on the Great Depression, noted as a macroeconomic view of the world. Talk a little bit about this concept of falling prices and how that fits into Ben Bernanke's worldview.
Well, first of all, I'd like to make the following observation. Mr. Krugman, recently a Nobel Prize winner in economics, he devoted 6,000 words to write an article entitled, How Did Economists Get It So Wrong? And he talks about economic theories. He also talks about Mr. Greenspan and Mr. Bernanke and so forth. Of course, he doesn't talk about himself. The article should have been entitled, How Did I Get It So Wrong? But in principle, what strikes me in this article of 6,000 words, that there is never, ever any mention about excessive credit growth, about leverage, about credit playing a destabilizing element in the business cycle. And he doesn't even mention, by going through the various economic theories, the Austrian School of Economics, that is a very important school. And I would argue also when you listen to Mr. Bernanke and Mr. Greenspan, very, very seldom did they ever mention excessive credit growth as a source or as a cause of destabilizing the economy and causing the problems. They just disregarded the excessive credit growth. And don't forget, credit grew or accelerated from a growth rate of 7% in 2004 when they started to increase interest rates to an annual growth rate of 18%. And debt to GDP, as you know, has grown from 130% in 1980 to now 375%, which still excludes the $59 billion of unfunded liabilities that arise from Medicare and Medicaid. So that someone who runs the central bank wouldn't pay any attention to this excessive credit growth, that really surprises me.
Now, take that and use a historical approach as well, because we know that Chairman Ben Bernanke is a student of the Great Depression, and there's something to be noted in his connection with what happened in the 1930s to what happened preceding that in the 1920s, or is there?
Yes, but the problem is the analysis that he constructs about the cause of the Depression is largely wrong. The Depression occurred for similar reasons that we have today, namely excessive credit growth in the 1920s and use of leverage and excessive speculation and so forth. And when the economy then no longer grew and prices fell, then we had this deflationary depression. His analysis of how to prevent the depression is probably correct, but the causes that led to the depression are not analyzed properly. So his medicine is just print more money. But don't forget, this is the medicine that they gave the patient, or I would rather say the poison that was given to the patient after 2001. And what did it do? It superimposed on the Nasdaq bubble another gigantic bubble, namely the housing bubble. And where did it bring us to? If you look, say, at today's employment figures, today there are less people employed than in 1999 in the United States, but the population has grown by 30 million. The whole expansion